Hi, I'm in the process of building a new 3D printer, and in this video I want to go over the setup and config of my new control board. I ended up going with the Big Tree Tech Manta V2 and the CB2 control module, as I heard good things about them. The thing is that there was a lot more setup than I originally thought, and by this I don't mean configuring Klipper to run my custom 3D printer, but just getting Klipper to run smoothly on these boards. But since I just got it running and the steps are still clearly in my head, I wanted to make this video so you can get an idea of what is involved. I can revisit this video if I need to make any changes, and maybe it helps one or two who are stuck during the setup process. Before this, I have never worked with a big two-track board, nor have I run Klipper, so there was quite a steep learning curve. I have split up the setup in four different tasks. These are flashing the CB2 compute module and upgrading the firmware, flashing the Manta board and setting it up for CAN bus communication, checking the CAN bus communication also in the CB2 compute module, and then finally setting up a base Klipper configuration. There's quite a bit of information and documentation out there about setting up these boards, but they're not always on the same update level, so that doesn't mean that they really work together. There are also quite a few sponsored videos on YouTube, but in my experience they not always show the whole installation process or are for a specific 3D printer, so in some cases they're more confusing than really helping. To get the Klipper image on the CB2, you will need an SD card. However, this is the only time where there's a need for one. First, get the latest image from the CB2 repository. Then, flash the SD card. You can use the Raspberry Pi Imager or any of the other tools like Balena Etcher. After unplugging it and plugging it in, you should see two partitions. In one of the partitions, you will find the system config file. Here we can change the name of the printer and also put in our Wi-Fi credentials so we can access it remotely. Save and exit the file and unplug the SD card again. Plug in the SD card into the board at the bottom in the SD card slot labeled SoC or System on a Chip and power up the board. You don't need to change any other switches or connect any jumpers. All the lights at the bottom left as well as the power light on the right should light up. After a little while, also the green action light should be flashing. This means that the operating system is loading. Now we can access the board. For this, we need the IP address of the system. I use the Angry IP scanner for this. If you can remember the password of your router, looking into the router network list is even easier, but any other tool works as well. To access the board, I'm using PuTTY and we will connect via SSH using the IP address. To log into the board, we will use the username and password BQ. Now we run our first command. After putting in the password, we will need to select what we want to install. Here we will choose first boot from EMMC, system on EMMC, and then choose the file system ext4. This can take a while, and after power off, shut down the system and remove the SD card as we won't be needing it anymore. Then we can power the system back on. And now if the action light will also blink, it means that we now have a booting system. This allows us now to connect to the main CellOS via our browser. Under Machine tab, check and update all the things on the right. I will be also removing everything with Obico in the name, as I won't be using it. And this is everything we need for the CB2 setup. Flashing the Manta board is a bit more involved. Here I will also not be using the process shown in the BTT Manta documentation. I will be using the Catapult software to flash the Manta board from the CB2. I saw this approach by the YouTube channel Dr. Klipper, and he also has a really good written guide on it. This approach has the added benefit that once set up, I can always update the firmware on the Manta board remotely. To do this, we first will put the Manta board into bootloader mode. For this, press and hold the boot 0 and then tap the reset button. Afterwards, we reconnect to the CB2 via SSH. Now to check if the Manta board is in bootloader mode, we can use the command lsusb, meaning listusb, and there should be an entry for our board. Then we will need to install Catapult by cloning the repository. and afterwards going into the directory. As the image version of the CB2 we got from the BTT website is a bit older, we need to go back a few releases. Now with the command make menu config, we will set up the config to flash the Manta with Catapult. Here we will select the ST microelectronics chip and the processor model STM32H723. We can also increase the clock frequency to 25 MHz and leave the rest as it is. Finally, we can enable a status LED by providing the PC3 GPIO pin so we can check if the system is in bootloader mode. With all these, we can press Q to exit and save. To compile, we run make J4 and then use the DFU util command to flash the port. The mass erase part of this command is optional. If an error occurs, you can leave it out. This can take a while, and in the end, look for file downloaded successfully. After a quick reset of the board, the status LED that we just configured should be flashing, indicating that the board is in bootloader mode. This step so far was only to be able to flash the Manta STM32. As said, there are other options and ways to do it, but like this, we don't have to use an SD card or so on. Now we can actually compile Klipper for the Manta. For this, go into the Klipper directory and we can use the command make menu config to set up the port. First, enable the extra-low configuration options and then select again the ST microelectronics chip, the processor model STM32H723, and increase the clock reference to 25 MHz. This config is almost the same as the one in the Manta documentation, but with a CAN bus. Therefore, we need to set the CAN interface to USB to CAN bus bridge, USB on PA11, PA12, and the CAN bus interface to CAN bus on PD0, PD1. Finally, the CAN bus speed can be left as it is at 1 MHz. We again exit by pressing Q and saving the config. Also, we again compile using the make J4 command. Now for flashing the board, we need a Python serial library. Depending on the CB2 image version, you will need to go to the sources list and uncomment all entries to be able to load the serial library. Then you can install via sudo apt install python-free-serial. If the package manager still can't find the library, make sure to update the packaging tool. And then flash the Manta board using the serial interface. Here the serial interface address TTY-AMC0 should always be the same. Otherwise you can check with the diagnostics command DMESG-HW. Now when checking the USB with the list USB command, the board should be listed as follows. This means that the board now runs Klipper and has a CAN bus interface. At this point, the status LED indicating the bootloader mode should have also stopped blinking. With this, the quote-unquote difficult part is done, and we can now check and configure our setup. Now we can check if the CAN bus is also running on the CB2 as intended and get the right CAN bus ID of the Manta board. For this, we first check the file in the following directory and make sure that it says what it's on the screen. After exiting the file using the command IPA, we can check if the CAN bus is in the setup mode. Next, we will get the UUID of the Manta board. For this, we need to stop Klipper and then look for the IDs with the following Python script. Here, make sure to take note of your individual ID as we'll need it for the next step, setting up a base Klipper configuration. And then restart Klipper or power cycle the board. The last step is then to set up a base Klipper configuration. For this, we will get the latest CFG file from the BTT GitHub. After downloading, best rename it to just printer.cfg. Now we open it, and at this stage it's also best to add the main-cell config link. Now we will also need the UUID that we just found out, and we will put it under MCU while commenting out the serial communication. Now we can access the Mindcell OS again. Here we can then upload the new config as our new printer. Best to open it and check if it's the one we just set up, and after save and restart we should now get the error that the ADCs are out of range. This means that the CB2 is communicating with the Manta, but there are some safety features that are blocking a correct startup. By connecting some appropriate temperature probes or only a 100K resistor, we can get the board to start up fully. With this, the board and the controller is set up and the actual Klipper configuration can begin. As my 3D printer is not yet finished, I will be doing this over the next couple of weeks and try to document it. See you in the next one.